हेलो, अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स। आई एम डॉक्टर जावेद अहमद उजैन, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जूलॉजी, शाह अब्दुल लतीफ यूनिवर्सिटी, खैरपुर। सो टुडे वी हैव कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ प्रीवियस टू लेक्चर्स अबाउट द एबायोटिक फैक्टर्स, एंड द टेबल ऑफ कंटेंट फॉर टुडेज लेक्चर वुड इंक्लूड द फैक्टर्स इन डिटेल, स्टडी ऑफ फैक्टर्स इन डिटेल लाइक वाटर एंड लाइट। सो we are going to start them and then other factors will be studied in another lecture. So abiotic factors are those factors which are non-living components of ecosystem are known as abiotic factors according to Dr. K. Rama Rao. So these non-living components means not made up of living thing includes the water, includes the atmosphere, includes temperature, includes soil chemistry, includes sunlight, includes wind, or we can say that will include the study of water chemistry, include the study of climate, and also include the study of soil. So this is known as abiotic factors. So first factor is the water. As we know that water is very much crucial, very much important for all the living organism, whether it is a plant or an animal, because not only because it is base solvent of the food and chemical transformation necessity in with for the body materials, its role is vital in many aspects, and it constitute about from 70 to 90% of water of protoplasm, cytoplasm, almost all say the eukaryotic cells. Water available in cell in three forms for the cell, which gets the water in three forms, whether it is atmospheric moisture water, atmospheric moisture is invisible vapors known as humidity, or visible vapors known as fog or cloud. And second is the precipitation, means the amount of water which is falling in a liquid form is known as precipitation, rainfall, the barsa karti hai unko hum precipitation kehte hain. जो एटमॉस्फेयर में वाटर वेपर्स होते हैं, वो क्लाउड्स में होते हैं, जो नजर आए या ना नजर आ जाए तो उनको हम एटमॉस्फेरिक मॉइस्चर कहते हैं। और सॉइल मॉइस्चर वो पानी होता है जो रेन वाटर सॉइल के तह में पार्टिकल्स के साथ जमा हो जाता है, वो चीज सोर्स ऑफ वाटर होता है प्लांट्स के लिए, उसको हम सॉइल मॉइस्चर कहते हैं। क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ ऑर्गेनिज्म बेस्ड ऑन द क्वांटिटी ऑफ वाटर दे रिक्वायर। प्लांट्स plants as well as animals, they are classified according to the requirement of water. If the requirement the availability of water too much, then it will be beneficial for those who do love large quantity of water, but may not be beneficial who do not require large amount of water. So they are classified accordingly. There are three categories of plants as well as three categories of the animals according to the water requirement. First category for plants is hydrophytes. Means hydro means water, phytes plants. So these are the plants which require great or large quantity of water for their growth. Xerophytes are those plants which can tolerate extremely dry conditions and pass a long time without water. And xerophytes are intermediate plants which can, which require moderate amount of water. Similarly, for the animals, hydrophiles are aquatic animals which live and require large amount of water. Mesophiles are terrestrial animals which require moderate quantity of water, and xerophiles, they can tolerate extremely dry conditions. We are going to explain each one with, in detail. So, hydrophytes first, and plants are hydrophytes plants are categorized, they are adapted in hydrophytic environment in different categories such as free floating, such as rooted, such as submerged. Free floating, they float on the surface of water, and rooted, they have the roots in the soil, such as trapa roots in the soil, and submerged, they contact water only, being completely submerged in the mud, examples ceratophyllum. And free floating, they are Wolffia, Lemna, they are just free float on the surface of water. and rooted submerged hydrilla potamedicon, and there is still rooted emerged plants. They grow shallow waters and require excess quantity of water. Example, Sagittaria typha. And due to availability of water in plenty, the roots are otherwise the principal organs of water absorption in these hydrophytes. And root hairs, root caps are absent in hydrophytes and emergent forms, however, they hair the roots. Adaptation in xerophytes, they do adapt. We studied first category hydrophytes, then second category is about the xerophytes. So xerophytes, they have adapted in such a way that they can survive in just like stones, very shortage of water, where no requirement of too much water. They are again classified into three types. Xerophytes are classified into three types. They are succulents, they are ephemerals, they are xerophytes or dotlings. Sorry. Succulents are many xerophytes, but this mechanism for storage of water. For example, they absorb water storing tissue, they water storing tissues in roots known as asparagus, or in leaves, aloe, or stems in opuntia, cacti, euphorbia. They store their water in roots and others, you know, opuntia, cactus. They store water, their leaves are modified, so they conserve a lot of water for a long time in use. So they are succulents. Still another type is ephemerals. They are short-lived annual plants which complete their life cycle with a small period of 6 to 8 weeks when sufficient moisture is available. Since these plants avoid dry season, they are known as drought evaders, and their seed germination is followed by flowering without undergoing the vegetation. Example, Arabidopsis and Thelenia. And third category is xerophytes. They can can tolerate water stress and require less quantity of water for long time. They include trees, herbs, and shrubs. Third type in plants adaptation is mesophytes. Mesophytes are terrestrial plants which neither adapted particularly dry or particularly wet environment. They are mesophytic plants, and they require medium quantity of water for their growth. And similarly, adaptation takes place in case of animals. So animals categories are three types: hydrocoels, mesocoels, and xerocoels. In case of hydrocoels, they have flagella, they have cilia, they have antenna, and they are again classified into two types: primary aquatic and secondary aquatic. Primary aquatic hydrocoels are those which only live in water, just like fishes. They neither live it on land. But secondary aquatic are those who are primarily live on terrestrial life, but due to shortage of food or inhospitability of land or competition with other species, they return to the water, but they have lungs for their breathing. And they are known as secondary adapters of the water. They require a lot of water for their growth, propagation, reproduction. Example, mammals are cetacea, pinniped, and cereta. Second category of the animals are known as mesocoels. The mesocoels require the medium level of the water for their survival, neither terrestrial nor too much quantity of water, and they maintain their life necessities, and their quantity of water also varies from species to species. Arthropod, one example, have external covering of over the respiratory surface, so they help them not to lose too much water. Insects, myriapods, they have well developed covering over the respiratory surface and tracheal systems. These include planarians, earthworms, and amphibians, so they conserve what they require, but little amount of water, not too much. Then third category comes xerocoel type of animals. They require extremely low or similar amount of water for their survival. They are again classified into drought evaders and drought resistors. Drought evaders are usually dormant during the unfavorable conditions. When climate is very hot or dry, they pass this time. they undergo three activities. Either they undergo estivation or hibernation or incessment. Estivation is summer sleep, hibernation is winter sleep, and reduce their metabolic activities. Incessment, they make cyst around. During the hibernation, winter inactivity in endotherm takes place. These examples include bees, snakes, deer. And non-mammal undergoes estivation in summer sleep. They include some amphibian toads, lizard tortoises, crocodiles, salamanders. Incessant in protozoans, amphibians, they survive in unfavorable conditions by reducing their metabolic activity in lesser quantity of water. Then the third, the second category of zero seals comes. These are the drought resistors. Drought resistors animals having which remains active throughout the year. They resist the drought season, and they do remain active throughout the year. But they adapt themselves and morphophysiological adaptations to counter the aridity, to counter the heat and drought seasons, either store water or conserve it. They include some birds, they include animals avoid heat by adopting nocturnal habitat. Some rodents active in daytime periodically, but go and burrows in heat time. An animal like jack rabbit and desert fox, they adapted very well and reduce the need of water evaporation and regulate body temperature. Efficient radiators, their ears are efficient radiators, so they perform their all activities and resist the heat, and they can survive. Similarly, kangaroo rats and pocket mouse, they can survive independently on dry seeds and do not require drinking water for a long time, and they mostly absent sweet glands are greatly reduced. Then drought resistors continue score points. Snakes, lizards, they got impermeable skin to prevent loss of water. Camels, they save their water because they have the humps that contain the fat tissue. They this hump fat will work as insulator to not allow the heat flow towards whole body. So reduce metabolic water and they can survive for a long time. Excretion of uric acid in birds, reptiles, kangaroo rats is also adaptation to conserve water. Then the second factor comes light factor. Second abiotic factor is light factor. Light also very important factor. Without light, life could not exist on earth. Because we all know that we ultimately depend on the plants, and plants ultimately depends on light for the process of photosynthesis to make their food, and we eat the plants, and ultimately we die. Plant dies, they are eaten by the microbes, so the cycle gets repeated. Recycling of materials takes place. Sunlight is the source. Sunlight, moonlight, starlight. So only from the ecological point of view, sunlight is very important, and only visible spectrum of solar radiant is visible for the process of photosynthesis. And this visible light from 390 micron to 700 micron is visible light. Other below 390 is ultraviolet, that makes 4% of the light, and above 760 is infrared or thermal radiation, which consists of 52% of the solar radiations. But only visible light is used for the photosynthesis, and variation in this light, quality of light, duration of light influence the ecosystem in various ways on animals as well as on plants. So effect on plants, chlorophyll production, stomatal movement, effect on transpiration rate, distribution of plants, photoperiodism means length of the daylight, exposure known as photoperiodism. Plants can be divided into short day, long day, neutral day according to length of time they get the light. Short day normally requires 12 hours to 14 hours, of light, example Salvia, Datura, and long day plants require 16 to 18 hours for the flowering of Brassica and Nigella. Neutral day does not affect it by length of the light or age or number of nodes, example Pua, Cucumis, and Nicotia. Coral vegetation plants may be classified according to tolerance of light. Is one category is heliophytes, other category is ascophytes. Heliophytes which grow best in full sunlight, ascophytes which grow best in lower intensities of shade. Effect of light on the animals, light effect on animal metabolism, ionization of protoplasm, enzyme activity increase with the temperature, and for example, normal development of salmon larva only occurs in presence of sufficient sunlight. Absence of light, salmon larva does not remain normal and mostly they die. In contrast, larvae of Mytilus grow well in darkness. So some effect on animals in this way, pigmentation of animals also affected due to the sunlight, amount of sunlight in Arctic boars and others, the color change of animals takes place accordingly. Sunlight and movement of animals also affected, such as the phenomena movement of animals in response to sunlight, towards the sunlight, in response to sunlight is called phototaxis, and Eugrina, Ranatra are positively phototactic because they move towards the sunlight, whereas birds, slugs, earthworm, poppy pot, planarians are negatively phototactic, they move away from sunlight. And light also controls the locomotory activity velocity of certain lower animals. This phenomenon known as photokinesis. Example, blind larva of mussel crab move faster if exposed to sunlight. So sunlight, plants and animals movement are also controlled. And light effects on reproduction. Some birds require high temperature or light illumination for their metabolic activity that they require less for even their sex requirement. And photoperiodism, amount of light each day cycle of the illumination followed by day of darkness is known as photoperiodism. The length of days has been found to be important factor to time the activities of organisms, such as development of gonads, molting, migration. They also require the light. The timing of different activities during the various part of annual our daily cycle is known as biological clock. It is assumed that photoperiod acts on hypothalamus through sensory receptors. In this way, the birds definite relationship between the day and they lay their eggs. Gonads of birds become more active with increased photoperiodism in case of summer season. Photoperiodism affects the activity of gonads and fishes, trout, for example, ordinary spawn in December can be induced lay eggs in August with artificial changing the length of the daylight. Freshwater snail can also not lay eggs in 11 hour day, but 12 or 13 or more hour of light they can lay eggs. Migratory birds are affected due to the photoperiodism and periodic rhythms. Rhythms with the periodicity of 12 hours are generally called circadian rhythms. Latin circa means about and dies means day. Whereas annual rhythms are known as circannual rhythms. These are maintained maintained through endogenous mechanism, although not fully well understood. But birds emerge, example is the birds, they emerge from the roosting places at dusk and they retain in this rhythm even when kept in complete darkness. Means there is a periodic rhythms, specific time or clock in which they perform their repeated activities. There is another example of Drosophila, they kept under constant condition from the larval stage, but they still emerge from the past with a regular circadian rhythm. There are certain times they repeat their activities, whatever condition we provide, they change according to their rhythm. The third factor, which is the environmental factor or abiotic factor, is the temperature, very important factor which affects on life of animal and plant would be discussed in the coming lecture on ecology. Allah Hafiz, Pakistan.